Hi, welcome to Red and April Off Grid. We recently announced that we're changing gears with our home build. After a couple months of testing Aircrete, we just decided it wasn't going to work for us and we're moving to more conventional materials. In this video, we'll be doing a cost comparison between the Aircrete home that we were previously planning on and the more conventional material home that we're planning to do now. The homes will be kind of different since we're using different materials, and so it's kind of hard to compare apples to apples perfectly, but we'll do the best we can here. The Aircrete home that we were wanting to build was going to be really well insulated and had really exceptionally thick walls and ceiling for an Aircrete home. We were planning on 8.5-inch thick walls and a 10-inch thick roof. And so that would have been pretty good insulation. If you calculate the R value of Aircrete at about 2 R per inch, then our 8.5-inch walls would have given us an R value of R17, and the roof, 10-inch thick, would have been R20. Now, we had also planned to put 2 inches of, or about 1.5 to 2 inches of spray foam on top of that roof and then coat that with an elastomeric sealant. And so that together would have been about R28 in the roof, which isn't incredible, but isn't too bad. And then we were hoping to get a little bit of kind of thermal mass benefit as well with the Aircrete wall and roof. Our new, more conventional plans will include actually a little better insulation. The R value in the wall will be R19, and the R value in the roof will be R38. So we're actually doing quite a bit better with the conventional home as far as R value, but we'll still compare those two together. So now I'll go into the Aircrete cost and break that down, how we figured what we figured. So we kind of did an Aircrete cost per batch, which was a 45-gallon batch, you know, made in a barrel. It's kind of the standard Aircrete mixture amount. And so we, you know, added up the amount of Drexel we would need for that, you know, the cement, the glycerin, the fiber. We were going to be adding all of that to every batch. We wanted the fibers just to make it, you know, extra strong. And so we planned that to use that in the entire build. And so we came to a total cost per batch of $15.73. Next, we figured out the amount of batches that would be needed. So we were going to be using it in the exterior walls, the interior walls, in the roof, and in the floor. Crunched the numbers on that, and we came out with the total number of batches for the entire house of 535. Figured that would have taken us, you know, around 2 months to do, or 2 months in straight days, so about 60 days total at 9 batches per day to pour that. So just, that's in total amount of days pouring, and of course there would have been set up and moving days in between there, so would have ended up taking longer. And that's counting about 4 hours a day just pouring and mixing Aircrete. So the total cost of just the Aircrete itself for a house would have been $8,259, and then you got to add the coating though. And so the way we figured the coating was using a good quality fiberglass mesh, using bonding agent in each batch of plaster or mix, and then the cement. And so we came out with just a rough price, and this may not be terribly accurate, but it was the best estimate we could come up with, of about 50 cents per square foot. And of course that's got to go on the inside and the outside, and so that's a whole lot of square feet for our house, but the total coating cost we came up with was just a little over $3,600. The cost of the coating to the cost of the Aircrete, you get just under $12,000. Now, that is also just counting for one coating of plaster, and we probably would have wanted to do more than that, especially on the exterior walls, so it would probably be a little more than that. Besides just the cost of the Aircrete and the coating themselves, I had to build a metal structure, or I would have had to build a metal structure, to, you know, bear the weight of the roof and to support everything together. And so just the metal for that metal structure was about $5,200. And then also, we needed some kind of a coating or sealer to go on the roof. And we also needed more R value, because the R value of 10 inches is only about 20, which isn't really enough for a roof. And so anyway, we needed to add some spray foam, and that stuff's pretty costly. That was about $5,500, and then some stuff for the fascia. So all in for, you know, the kind of the Aircrete walls, ceilings, and floor was about just a little over $23,000. To give you a little context on the metal structure part of it, we only paid $5,200 for the metal itself, which is a really great deal. We looked all over for, you know, the best prices on metal, and we finally found a place in Phoenix that we traveled to pick it up. And then there was some kind of a confusion and mix up when we got there. And anyway, super sweet people. They ended up giving us a really great discount. And so we got a really good deal on this. Normally this amount of metal would be, you know, in the $6,000 to $10,000 range. And so was really happy to find such a good deal on the metal structure. And to explain quickly, just, you know, kind of what I was planning there, I was planning to put two metal C-purlins back to back and make kind of like an I-beam, and then weld on kind of tops and bottoms to those so that you could bolt that beam down to the concrete footer. And so I was going to do an upright every 8 foot around the perimeter of the structure, and then put a top beam along the top to tie all those in together. And so the aircrete would have been filling in a space that was 8 feet up between the beams. And then the roof would have been made out of two C-purlins that were put back to back to make trusses. And those would have been spaced every 4 feet. And we would have been filling in the space in between those with aircrete. Of course, all through the metal structure, there would have been rebar reinforcing, crisscross bracing, especially in the roof. There would have been a lot of bracing all through. And then plus we're going to be using a heavy duty wire mesh to add extra support and rigidity and structural strength to the aircrete in the roof. And now moving on to the more conventional build that we're doing now. We're still, of course, making the same house, but we're making with more conventional materials. And so these numbers that you see here are actual numbers. We got these recently. We've already ordered a lot of the materials. And so these are an exact amount that we'll actually be paying for this. So the numbers on this are a lot closer than probably the number on the aircrete house. But it's still interesting to compare them. So we'll start with the walls on this. We've moved to, you know, more conventional walls. So it'll be actually 2x4 stud framing with 1.5 inches hard foam on the outside, and then sheeting on top of that. And of course, you know, vapor barrier layers and house wrap. And then on top of that, we're going to use a kind of a roofing metal, or just a metal siding, but it's going to be kind of metal roofing siding. And that should achieve a nice tight wrap around the house and give us an R value of 19. For the roof, we're going to use the same idea as the last one. We're going to use those C-purlins back to back, make I-beams. I'm still going to use 4 foot spacing on those with extra bracing. But, you know, we're going to use more conventional insulation methods, you know, sheetrock on the inside. Or, you know, we may actually go with something like a tongue and groove on the ceiling, something along those lines. Anyway, on top of the beams, we're going to do solid foam board, at least 2 inches thick, and then the sheeting, vapor barrier, all that kind of good stuff. And then, you know, top that off with a good heavy duty, you know, pro panel or, you know, roofing metal. And so it ought to be a good, solid, tight house. And the numbers actually come out surprisingly good. The total price, the comparative house, the, you know, the roof, walls, floor, for the conventional build is $21,824, so about $1,200 less than the aircrete house, or about 5% less, which we were actually surprised once we really crunched the numbers on a really well-built, really nice conventional build. This house is super solid. We're not cutting corners. It should be a really well-built, solid house that's tight and warm, and it's still coming in less than the price of the aircrete house. You know, and that was making the aircrete ourselves. So it's really surprising, about 5% less. So it's super nice that it's actually going to cost us less to go this route. And actually, I'm relieved, because the experience of pouring aircrete for me wasn't great. You know, making the aircrete itself, I found to be stressful. Like every time we would go to mix up a new batch, it was just kind of high intensity activity. You're really focused, and it was just kind of stressful trying to make it turn out right. You got to control everything and do it all just right. And I didn't enjoy the process. And honestly, the prospect of, you know, making aircrete for hours a day, for days and months on end, wasn't appealing. But we were still going to go for it. That's not why we decided to move away from it. But I'm actually relieved that we don't have to go that route. I've actually built several, you know, more conventional structures, and I really enjoy the process. I enjoy the carpentry. I enjoy using the different materials. And so I'm actually really looking forward to this build, looking forward to building my house more now that we've changed the materials. Also, I think it's going to go up a lot faster. Just from my experience of having done this kind of stuff before, you know, we'll be able to work through the cold winter months and won't have to kind of delay activities. And just the whole process of raising up a structure and getting it dried in goes a lot faster when you're using, you know, this material and these methods. I said that I built several structures using this method, but actually they've always been, you know, smaller structures. I built a freestanding garage. It was a 30-30 detached garage, and I built several additions and those kind of structures. But this will actually be my first full home to build, and really excited for it and looking forward to it. Thank you very much for watching, and if you'd like to continue to follow our journey, don't forget to like and subscribe and ring the bell icon, and we'll see you next time.